And we use also, you know, the information a lot. So what I will try to do is try to clarify what information is, what knowledge is, and try to shed some light on misuse and misunderstanding of these terms so that the meanings will be more clear. And then we will have questions and answers. I think any comments that you may want to make. I will also share the file after the presentation because we will have to go fast. You cannot, you know, resolve something this controversial in just 1 hour. Okay. First of all, information and meaning and the symbols, mind, their connections, whatever. Okay, here you see the triangle, okay? It is about the, it has the mind, the meaning, and the symbols. I will concentrate on this triangle. That is when we say information or knowledge, we should remember these three terms, the symbols, meaning, and mind. And if one of them is missing, then it is not information. That is, information should involve all three components. And the core here is meaning. That is, without meaning, you don't really have any information or knowledge. And symbols are physical things. They may be, you know, letters, sounds, whatever, or zeros and ones. You can see them physically. But meaning is non-physical. So they are combined together. Unless they are combined, you don't have information or knowledge. And the way you recognize it is through the mind. That is, if you don't have mind, or if there are no minds, okay, then there is no information to speak of. There is no knowledge. Okay, so information is meaning represented by physical symbols, okay? Normally, we know the symbols. Let's say you see the letters on the screen. They are the symbols. But if, let's say, you don't speak English, you can look at these letters, okay? Then it will make no sense to you. You will not call this information. You will just say a bunch of letters. And you have no idea what they are. To you, if you don't know English, it doesn't represent anything. So what we have here is really a protocol. That is, certain words mean certain things. So we have that common protocol in our mind, in our memory, so that when we see certain symbols, it evokes those meanings so that we understand it. And we see this as information. So information is meaning represented by physical symbols. And knowledge, usually knowledge and information, they are used interchangeably. And I will also do that. It is also meaning, but meaning that resides in the conscious mind. That is, you don't need two symbols. Information you can see out there, but you cannot see my knowledge. Unless I load that knowledge on symbols, which is my voice right now, okay? The sounds, or what I put on the screen as letters, then you can see it. But once knowledge, the meaning, knowledge is meaning, once that meaning is loaded on symbols, which can be sensed by others, it is information. It is the reason that information and knowledge, that they are used interchangeably there. Okay. And also keep in mind that consciousness is a key concept, and without consciousness, that is, without a conscious mind, we cannot speak of any knowledge. We have to be aware of it, okay? If I say you are not aware that you know something, then you don't know something. So consciousness is, again, a key aspect here, a conscious mind. And the symbols of information, they are simply the media of representation, and they are the means of transmission of information. You can, let's say, fax something, you can speak using the sound waves or whatever. That way you transfer the information using symbols, or you can write, you know, articles, books, whatever, or zeros and ones, that they are also symbols. And without meaning, the mere symbols of information have no significance, since meaning is an ascribed quality. That is, the symbols, they don't have meaning built in, okay? Meaning is attached by a conscious mind. And information exists only when the symbols of information interact with a conscious mind. If, let's say, all the people were to disappear as conscious beings, all the, you know, computer codes, zeros and ones, the books, these presentations, if, let's say, you are recording my voice, whatever, they are meaningless, okay? They make no sense to any other existence, only to conscious beings there. And without a common protocol or convention between the symbols and meaning, again, we cannot transmit meaning from one mind to another. That is, the presentation that I intend to make is really in my mind. But the thing is, you cannot see it. Although it is knowledge in my mind, so I have to load it to sounds or letters so that it is conveyed to you. It is transmitted to you. And then once you sense those symbols, because of the common protocol, the common language of English, okay, you simply attach the meaning back to those symbols. And that way the meaning in my mind is transmitted to your mind as meaning. So my knowledge becomes information out there, and then knowledge in your mind there. Okay, therefore, knowledge is meaning in the mind, and information is symbols plus meaning, okay? It is described by the mind. So as you see, in a conscious mind, we have this meaning, but outsiders cannot see it. Information, we have all these, you know, symbols, letters, sounds, whatever the physical entities. And when a conscious mind, it can be you, when let's say you see these symbols or hear them or whatever, okay, then you perceive it as information. Now the interconnection, for example, some questions: can robots have knowledge, and do plants have knowledge? For example, you can see a lot of processes like photosynthesis in plants. If you keep the definition in mind that information is meaning ascribed to symbols by a conscious mind, and knowledge is meaning that resides in conscious minds, then the answer is very clear. Let's say here we have the humanoid Erica and human being. See, they can have a nice conversation. They can speak, talk, act. Maybe you cannot even tell them apart who is really alive and who is not. But keep in mind that unless you don't have a conscious mind, you cannot have information and you cannot have knowledge. So Erica, you know, she may speak English fluently, ask her questions, okay? She may answer just correctly. She may speak like 20 languages, okay? But she does not know anything. Why? Because she is not aware of any of the things that she is saying, okay? So a conscious mind is a prerequisite for knowledge. Therefore, all the smart devices, all the robots, Erica, you know, whatever, all the entities that have no conscious mind, okay, they have no knowledge. They cannot have knowledge. The same with plants. You can say that, oh, look at this apple tree here, okay? It looks like they take the, you know, ingredients from the soil and water, the sunlight, and somehow like a chemical factory, they convert them to apples. We don't have the technology right now. That is, we cannot really use the soil, water, energy, and convert them to apple like this with no noise, waste, no nothing there. So are the plants knowledgeable beings? Again, the answer is no. Okay, I think it's safe to say that plants, they don't have any consciousness. The only conscious beings are humans and the complex animals to a limited extent. But the plants, they don't have any mind. They don't have any consciousness. Therefore, they cannot have any knowledge. Same, let's say, with the leaves. The leaves are also like a chemical factory that converts solar energy into chemical energy. But again, they are not aware of what they are doing. Therefore, although they exhibit information so that we can understand what is going on, they don't have any knowledge. They don't know anything. Therefore, we can say that the information out there exists in the plants implicitly, okay? But unless someone notices it, it doesn't become explicit. That is a photosynthesis, for example. It was out there before the human beings and in early stages of human beings. We noticed it probably during the last few hundred years, okay? So before then, no mind was aware of photosynthesis. But right now we know it. Okay, so did we add knowledge? No, it is still the same photosynthesis there. But it was out there to be discovered. So it was implicit. Once we know it, it becomes explicit. And when several people know it, we say it is common knowledge. I think the proper term is maybe common information there. Okay, now the symbols of information. Here's a long list. As you know, what the symbols of information can be. It can be like physical states of assemblies of letters, numbers, signs, patterns, zeros and ones, DNA strands, whatever. It can be like the bodily dispositions like body language, sign language, art. It can be the languages, okay? That is a lot of words, for example. So lots of possibilities there. But again, keep in mind that symbols facilitate the transmission of meaning, okay? And they have no intrinsic meaning of themselves. And meaning is an immaterial entity. It exists in the mind, and the meaning cannot be perceived by the five senses, but the symbols can. So it is important to have that common protocol as to what meanings are ascribed to what symbols, okay? Now, something interesting in quantum mechanics entanglement, okay? That is, normally Einstein says nothing can exceed the speed of light, which is true for physical things, okay? But entanglement is also a fact. That it is, just observed not only once, not only by one person, but, a lot of times, but a lot of people. So it looks like it is a scientific fact. What is it? It is information transmitted in no time, okay? Normally, it is not surprising because the information has two components. One is meaning, one is symbols. Symbols are physical things. Meaning is not physical thing. And for non-physical things, time and space is irrelevant. Therefore, non-physical things can travel and can exist timelessly, okay? They don't need any time. So as long as you don't transmit the zeros or ones, for example, okay? Or light, then you don't have any limit there. Therefore, if you look at the subatomic particles, as entities that can communicate without symbols, okay, that is receive and transmit meaning, then I think that dilemma is resolved. It is the same as telepathy in people. That is, you can sense something, you can get this information or something. It doesn't always happen, so we don't have strong rules for it. But telepathy is, it is also out there. That is information transformation without any symbols involved. No light, no words, no bodily language, no nothing. So it exists there among people. And so in subatomic particles, it also exists. Therefore, if you look at information as symbols plus meaning, these things are easier to explain. Often we merge meaning and we bury meaning into symbols. The reason is, anytime, let's say, we see a word, we know what it means. And we think that we are conditioned that word has that meaning in it. Let's say when we say apple, okay? We see the apple in our mind. But it is only if you speak English. If let's say you don't know the English, you can say, apple, and the other person will see nothing in his or her mind, okay? Therefore, the sound apple or the letters, APPLE, they don't have meaning built in. The meaning is ascribed by a protocol there. But since the mind sees the apple, the symbol, the picture, the word, whatever, and immediately that meaning lights up in the mind, we kind of combine them. And we don't think about the meaning. We just say, the shell, the symbols, they involve the meaning there. And we think the symbols of information is the information itself, okay? And this is a huge misunderstanding, and it is very common. Okay, and also, when the symbols disappear, the meaning also is gone. So you think the meaning comes from the symbols there. Also keep in mind that if there are no minds, there would be no information to speak of. And learning a language is a process of matching symbols with conceptions. That is linking syntax with semantics there. And the symbols are, of course, easy to identify since they are visible. But the existence of meaning, since it is a mental entity, it is often denied. Okay, so meaning, what meaning? What are you talking about? I just see the symbols, that's it. I understand it, okay? Because the meanings are mental imagery there, and we don't physically see it. Okay, now transmission of information in the ICT. Also keep in mind that transmission of information is really transmission of symbols only, okay? For example, right now when I speak, and also the visuals, they are converted to really zeros and ones, okay? And what you receive is on the other end, zero and one, and the speaker simply converts those zeros and ones based on the protocol, to sounds, and you receive the sounds, and the sound, since you know English, you understand. That is, during transmission, we really send only symbols, okay? And the other side, the receiving end, receives also only symbols. That is, when we send information, the meaning is detached. And once the information reaches the other side, the meaning is reattached, okay? Let's say I send you a sentence. Let's say this is a visual here. All I do is just send what you see here. I don't send any meaning. And if let's say you don't speak English, this is just bunch of things. Okay, the pictures you can understand, but the letters you cannot. So what you do is you reattach the meaning from your mind here, okay? But somehow we miss that point. That is, the transmitted symbols, they must evoke the same meaning in the minds at both ends of transmission, okay? And in communication, transmission of information really means simply transmission of symbols of information. And if all the humans in the world were to vanish today or tomorrow, okay, all the information would vanish, as a science writer Horgan says. Why? Because the meaning is in the minds, and the meaning will be gone. What do we have left? Just symbols, bunch of, you know, physical symbols, arrangements of zeros and ones, letters, this and that. If let's say conscious beings from another planet later on came and saw, let's say, all those books, I don't know, zeros and ones, whatever, they'll look at it and they will have no idea if it represents something. They will not look at it as information, and they cannot benefit from it unless they decode it somehow. Okay?
Yunus Hocam, I guess you mean all the information that we have, right? You're going to talk about it, I guess.
Humans, yes.
Yeah. Otherwise, if the humans vanish, we have other information that's used by other beings. Yes, they are not conscious of it, but we can see the information there.
Okay, right? let's
say it this way. Apple tree, the photosynthesis.
Yes, that is the photosynthesis will be there. The apples will be made. They were also, you know, were being made by, let's say, without any human noticing them. Okay.
They don't mean anything.
Okay, is it information? Yes, I call it the intrinsic information. Because if you take the humans as reference, we don't see it. So I think if you take the humans out and then you see the information, okay, you discover it, the meanings, okay. Now that means there is a conscious mind which is grander than the human beings, okay? Because we don't make, let's say, the photosynthesis, whatever we see in nature out there. So it is the bigger dimension. But right now, I am limiting the presentation only to what we perceive as information and knowledge. That is, I'm taking only humans as reference, but this can be, of course, extended, okay? Let's say in the world, if there are no conscious beings who can understand, I think, the meaning of the symbols or see the representations there, okay, then, if no meaning occurs in any mind, because there is no conscious mind, then we cannot speak of any information, okay? Now in a blender, but sometimes let's say, you see people saying that if you take a book and put it in a blender, okay, that information is lost. They give this example for black holes or whatever, kind of information being lost. I think this is just a baloney. It is not information. What you have on paper is symbols of information. Nothing happens to information because the core of information is meaning, which exists in conscious mind, okay? Likewise, if let's say there is a fire in a library, okay, and all the books are burned, if you have the same books in other libraries or other places, okay, a lot of books are gone, but no information is lost. Information is still out there. So the symbols of information is not information because it doesn't have meaning. So even if they are destroyed, if let's say that information exists even in one conscious mind, okay, it is still information existing. And the web browsers, for example, what do you do?
Yunus Hocam, can we interrupt your presentation or do you prefer
certainly,
to?
Certainly, sure, yes. Uh-huh.
Okay. This brings into my mind Socrates. You know, it is told that Socrates asks questions to his students or followers at the time. By asking questions, he is just bringing all the knowledge from somebody. So let's say that I feel like I don't know anything, but Socrates asks me such questions that I bring the knowledge out. Is this something related? I mean, is information coded in my mind, something to be decoded by some means, or I gain the information on the way, just reading these symbols?
I will get to that, okay? After a few slides, I discuss just that.
All right.
So let me just, let's spend a few minutes on that one. And you can interrupt me anytime with any question. Okay, now let's say the mind information knowledge connection. The philosopher Shoemaker, he argues that this meaning, it is immaterial, so it cannot be reduced to physical symbols. That is, meaning doesn't stem from it. And he gives this metaphor. He says, to say that life is nothing but a property of certain peculiar combinations of atoms is like saying that Shakespeare's Hamlet is nothing but a property of a peculiar combination of letters. The truth is that the peculiar combinations of letters is nothing but a property of Shakespeare's Hamlet. The French or German versions of the play own different combinations of letters. This is, the emergence phenomena, which is commonly used, especially in our sciences, saying that when you arrange things, organize in a certain way, and then meaning simply, just appear out of nowhere, okay? Some will say they are rooted in the symbols. Some will say they just appear from out of nowhere, but they are still there. Here, I think Shoemaker makes the point that, let's say, when you read a book, it is simply a combination of letters. They don't have any meaning. But in your mind, you have the meaning of every letter, every phrase, every sentence. It's simply evokes the meaning. Without a mind, those letters mean nothing. Likewise, let's say life. You can see life on physical things. Let's say the bodily, organs, atoms, cells, but the organ in a certain way, but they don't make the life. Life is not rooted in this organization there. Okay, on the consciousness, as I mentioned before, it is the key to understanding knowledge, because if, let's say, you are not aware of what you know, then you don't have any knowledge. So consciousness is a must, a conscious being. So the core of the phenomenon of knowledge is consciousness. Therefore, humans have high level of consciousness. Higher animals, they have low level of consciousness. Plants have no level of consciousness. For example, the higher animals, let's make a comparison. They are conscious of the leaves, so they know where to go for grazing and when. Humans, we also know that, but we also know that the chemical processes in the leaves, and we can even build artificial leaves, because of the knowledge that we have. But if, let's say, we remained as hunter-gatherers, competing with other animals for food, shelter, whatever, that low level of consciousness, then there would be no difference between humans and animals, and we would simply deplete the resources in our environment to preserve our livelihood. Now, what sets humans apart from other species is the high degree of consciousness and their high potential to acquire knowledge. And this potentiality comes with a unique mind in human beings, equipped with intrinsic ability for high awareness, vivid imagination, deep thinking, comprehensive understanding, and the joy of learning, So it is not the genes that makes us different. Genetically, we are not really much different than other species. 90, you know, some percent, all are the same. But this, you know, what we call the mind, the potentiality of a unique mind with very high level of awareness, imagination, thinking, understanding, and the pleasure of learning. I think this sets us apart, and this is the core of human civilizations here. And let's say if you look at the machine learning, again, I think it is a misnomer there, okay? Machines, no matter how sophisticated they are, they may, let's say, beat players in chess or Go games, whatever. Keep in mind that they don't know anything. They don't know how to play a game. They don't even know what game is. They don't even know what Go game is, okay? They simply, let's say, can master the mechanics there without knowing anything. Therefore, the machines, since they don't have any consciousness, and they will never have, I can argue that, they don't really know anything. For example, the Siri in iPhone. You can ask any questions and the Siri will answer. It doesn't mean that it knows anything. And also, let's keep in mind that everything is made of information, okay? And if, let's say, during archaeological excavations, if you find a cylindrical marble column or a pot, you know, like this, when, let's say, you see something, which reflects some intent and some knowledge, okay? You know that they are knowledgeable beings with intent behind it. Therefore, anytime you see things that utilize information and intention, okay, then there is a conscious being with intent, knowledge behind it. Therefore, when let's say you look at the photosynthesis, the leaves, okay, obviously there is knowledge there, there is intent there, and there is unity. So there must be a knowledgeable being, okay, with intent and power behind it. If let's say you want to look at the big picture. Let's say as soon as let's say we find this during excavation, okay, we say, oh, stop, human beings did this. Why? Because this cannot happen by itself. Obviously, you know, some knowledge is used here. It is done intentionally. The laws and forces of nature cannot cause a structure of this kind. And obviously there is a purpose here. Okay.
Yunus Hocam, can I just ask a question? Uh-huh. As you clearly mentioned here, when we look at this pot, nobody argues that it is done, it is built by a conscious person or a team. But why is it really difficult to conclude that a tree is built or created by a conscious existence? I mean, why the first one is clearer than the other one? Although we as believers, it's more clear for us in the second one, I mean, in the tree, it's more clear for us that it is created than compared to the pot being built. I mean, why scientific community, or why is it hard to conclude in the second one? You know,
I think
showing a lot of reasoning behind.
Yeah, because we are blinded, okay? Let's say apples, okay? You simply, you know, put a seed into the soil, you wait, you see, you know, it's sprouting, you know, some green things happening, branches forming, leaves, whatever, and you don't see anything behind it, okay? But that is, you have seen trees being made, apples being made without any maker, okay? Then in your mind, you say, oh, you know, they just occur there by themselves. But you have never seen a pot like this just occurring by itself, okay? You may have, you know, a stone of irregular shape. Okay, it occurs by itself under the influence of laws and forces of nature, okay? Or you may have, let's say, deep valleys, you know, whatever. But you have never seen anything like this that occurs under the influence of natural causes, laws and forces of nature. Okay, so we learn that anytime you see something like this, Okay. It is made by man, meaning conscious being with knowledge, intent, and purpose. Okay. Because nowhere in the world we saw in a simple thing like this. Therefore, a thinking person should, I think, generalize saying that if, let's say, even this simple pot, okay, made of soil, as soon as I said the archaeologists, you know, find this, it is labeled as an kind of what an archaeological artifact there, okay, and no one objects. When we see, let's say, a butterfly, I don't know, an egg, an apple, whatever, we should think the same thing. They are much more marvelous than those, because if we were to try to make an apple, for example, okay, probably we might be able to do it. Okay, it is, the technology level is, you know, so high there. Let's say in 3D printing, okay, which is also called additive manufacturing, it is simply manipulation and arrangement of matter as dictated by the information encased in the software. That is, if let's say you see a machine, for example, doing this, we can do this, let's say, using 3D printing. But we know that behind it, there is a knowledgeable person with intent and purpose and the power to manipulate the material and writes the code, gives the instruction. So even though we see like the machine doing it, from experience, we know that there is a, you know, person, okay, which wrote the software using the information and the mind there and the purpose. So I think it is simply we are blinded. There is a, you know, curtain of blindness. We simply cannot see behind, okay? Just blind is nothing else, because laws and forces of nature cannot do anything purposive, anything that requires knowledge. Okay, now, can there be knowledge without a conscious mind? The answer is no. The mind is the necessary external agent of information. At the universal scale, you can look at the mind of the creator, okay? At the, let's say, limited scale that within the circle of our awareness, you can look at the human mind. The animal mind, they are much simpler, so we can just concentrate on the humans here, okay? For example, dictionaries, okay? They have a lot of information or encyclopedia, but unless there is a mind, okay, they are simply piles of inked paper, nothing else there, okay? And the intellect, imagination, memory, consciousness, sense of self, whatever, these all are related. They are part of the mind, okay? The mental faculties. No one denies the existence of the mind, but they call it, some call it an illusion, for example. Some claim it is the creation of the brain, which is again baseless because brain is simply a material thing, just like a microprocessor. And the material things cannot create cohesive non-material things there, which are agents, okay? So a lot of I think opinions on that one, because the concepts are not clear. The reason they give, for example, that brain makes these things, they say losing consciousness or memory after a brain injury shows that brain makes them. If the brain is out of order, so is consciousness, whatever. Okay, this is the what explanation they give. But keep in mind that if you take your, you know, smartphone, okay, and if let's say the microprocessor here is somehow damaged, then you will not be able to watch any YouTube videos or anything really. It doesn't mean that microprocessor is damaged, no YouTube videos. It is fixed, okay, YouTube videos. That means the microprocessor is making those YouTube videos, okay? So claiming that, you know, brain does all the consciousness, all the minds, all the whatever, okay, is just like this example, and there is no proof of it, okay? Unless, let's say, people build artificial brains that can generate a mind and consciousness, okay, that claim is worthless. It has no proof there. It is simply the result of a worldview, the materialistic worldview. They want to limit existence to material things, that reductionist view, okay? But again, it doesn't hold any water there. And electrical activity in the brain, it is called information processing. It is not really. The electrical activity doesn't process information. It processes signals, okay? Just like symbols, signals have no meaning, okay? It is just like, let's say you want to turn your AC on in the car. What you do is you press a button. That button, what it does is generates a signal, okay? And then following some commands, initiates the turning on of the air conditioning device, okay? It doesn't transmit any meaning there. Only single signal processing. This person has all the meaning and the intent and the purpose, whatever there. That is the brain signals. They don't really do anything. They don't generate meaning there. And if you look at, let's say, a person sleeping or awake, the brain activity, electrical signals, all are just continue full speed. But when we sleep, nothing happens, no information. Or when we are in coma, for example, okay, again, no information. That is the brain activity, obviously, is not doing it, okay? And if let's say we continue, for example, photovoltaic cells in solar collectors, PVs, when we receive, let's say, the photons here, okay? They knock out electrons and they generate current, okay? And electric signals here, electrical activity. And you can even light, let's say this light bulb here, but there is no information. All those signals don't generate any information. Or the signals in microprocessors, they don't generate any information. Let them run, okay? They just keep running, all those transistors. Similarly, let's say when the light strikes the eye, the retina, again, a signal is generated and the signal goes to the brain, okay? Electric signal. And that electric signal, okay, just ends somewhere and that's it. That's it. That brain material cannot do anything. All we know after that is we see something, okay? And that vision is constructed. We don't see what is out there because there is no light in our head. We see what is constructed inside using, you know, our knowledge in an amazing 3D renderings there. So obviously there is something enigmatic, very powerful, that is using these signals to render other things. And that meaning is also associated with that thing. Therefore, information, it is often portrayed as agency. That is, information does these things. But keep in mind that knowledgeable, skilled agent, okay, information is not this. It is simply inept symbols, information. Yet, you will see information is a powerful and knowledgeable, mystical agent that reads the information itself, understands it, applies it skillfully, subjugate and organize matter, okay? So information is portrayed as an enigmatic agent, capable agent, with intent, knowledge, skill, and power to rule matter. But there is no ground for it. They are just delusions, okay? Because what they see as information are just symbols, and the symbols cannot do anything. They are not even aware of themselves there. Even the five senses, okay? What we get into the brain is just a lot of electric signals, okay? And then they are converted to sounds, sights, smells, taste, whatever. All of these are non-physical. They are mental constructs, construct. There is nothing physical called smell. We have the molecules, okay? And we have no taste, okay? All we get in the brain is electric signals, nothing else. And depending on the waveform, somehow, something, there must be an agency there. Kando builds, smells, sounds, tastes, visuals, whatever. Okay, so it is not only the meaning, it is a lot of other things. It is just like, you know, Matrix, the movie, okay? It is like, you know, if you want to ask some questions, what is the basic fabric of existence? Does information form the very core of existence? Is information primary, okay? More fundamental than matter energy? Is the universe a giant information process and digital computer? Is reality just an animation of information? Are we just holographic images rendered by computers? Is the worldview of a digital philosophy, okay, plausible? If you look at this, okay, I think that these are interesting questions there, interesting questions. But keep in mind that at the end, we only have the symbols of information, okay? And unless there is behind it a mind with intent, with power, with knowledge, okay, even this holographic universe cannot be formed. The symbols, the zeros and ones, will not do anything. And intuition, as Harun asked, it is also a source of information, okay, and it's a mental perception. That is, now we have the physical perception through our five senses, but sources of knowledge, they are really the the physical perception, the five senses, and then mental perception. See, we are thinking, okay, and we get, let's say, inspirations, intuition, whatever, and then we read from internet, whatever, the knowledge of others. So these are the three primary kinds of information. And the mental perception, it is called introspection. It is like the state of minds, the emotions, memory, thoughts, intuition, instinct, inspiration, whatever. All of these are sources of information, okay? And the inspiration, for example, just, you know, strikes your mind. That is, it gets from somewhere, even sometimes during your dream. And the inspiration is most important information because it doesn't exist out there. It is a brand new there, okay? And sometimes we call it, you know, a stroke of genius. So the last part, information. Is it a knowledgeable, skilled agent or a pile of—
Yunus Hocam, can I interrupt once again? It's really— Yes? Interesting on the intuition side. Can I ask a question of the heart? Sure. I know scientists don't believe in or don't perceive the heart as an— Mm-hmm. —agent, but, you know, as Islamic body of knowledge, we get the heart as a core faculty of human being. So what we understand, for example, all the inspirations are in the heart. So— Mm-hmm. —how can we relate the faculty of heart with the knowledge? Or is it kind of a degree of knowledge which is not known to many people living in this world?
Now I use the phrase mind generally, okay? It is the non-physical existence in the human beings, the agency that rules the human body. Itself is a non-material, non-physical, and it is in contact with a lot of non-physical things out there. To give an example, let's say the sound, okay? The sounds that we hear. Outside, we know sounds are, you know, the waves. Air waves there, vibrations of air molecules. We associate waves with our sound. But in our mind, okay, when we get those signals, there are no vibrations. And somehow, those electrical signals, which are just like the taste, vision, smell, whatever, the sound electrical signals, they are converted to, you know, boom, 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 boom sounds. That those vibrations, they don't come from out there. They are created in the mind. It looks like there is a world of sound. It is non-physical, okay? A world of smells, non-physical. That is, we sense all those things. And let's say emotions that we have, the pain, pleasure, happiness, you know, all those things. Heart is known as the center of emotion. And for, let's say, intuition, we feel like it is in the heart, but I am combining all of it in the word mind. You can also call it the soul, okay? And then simply look at different compartments and assign different centers there. But these are all non-physical, and they are in communication with non-physical things. Information, the meaning itself is non-physical. Therefore, the mind, including the heart, is in constant contact with a physical realm of ideas, emotions, senses, whatever, everything.
Thank you, Hocam. Amazing.
Okay. Now, the last topic, information. Okay. It is presented as a powerful informed agent. Okay. With intentionality. Such a powerful agent, that it has the capacity to inflict change and to organize matter. For example, one of the articles on information, Stonier says, information is defined operationally as possessing the capacity to organize a system. Okay? Information does not have that capacity because information, okay, is simply the symbols, physical symbols, and then the meaning that comes from conscious minds, nothing else. Information cannot do anything. So defining information as a capacity to organize matter, okay, this is really just a delusion. Why people do that? Because they want to remain within the limits of material existence, physical existence, okay? They don't want to go beyond matter and energy because they think it will be non-scientific, which is not the case. The domain of inquiry of science is matter, energy, physical things, okay? But the domain of existence is much broader, and all the physical things, they also involve non-physical things. It is called, you know, they call it emergence phenomena, but the meaning, for example, okay? You cannot explain anything without a meaning there. Anyway, information is not an active agent, not an engineer, and it has no capacity to organize a physical system. And information does not and cannot have causal power. It cannot cause anything. For example, we know that too much salt is bad for you, but that information doesn't keep me from eating too much salt. Or we have, let's say, a lot of how-to books, right? How to make a, you know, perfect pizza, how to clean your room, how to whatever. That information, let's have to clean your room, will not clean your room. Information cannot do anything. It is not an agent. It doesn't have any knowledge there. Okay. Therefore, I think information should be put into its proper place. Same thing, let's say here. Let's say this is a book by Paul Davis. He says, for example, the unifying concept that underlies this transformation is information, not in its prosaic sense, but as an abstract quantity which, like energy, has the ability to animate matter. Now, he defines life, for example, as matter plus information in this book, published last year, okay? Information has nothing to do with life, creating life. But if you limit your existence to matter energy only, okay, then, you know, you say things that make no sense and are not plausible. And he says, like, patterns of information flow can literally take on a life of their own, kind of life creating, I mean, the information creating a life. Or from this rich and complex ferment of information that the concept of agency emerges. Information creating an agency which will subjugate matter and move things around. I think this is just pure imagination. There is no such thing, okay? It is important because of this that it is important to understand what information is not. If you don't clarify the concepts, then you can say anything you want here. Now, the symbols of information, okay, like the words and zeros and ones, okay. Again, they are presented as an agent that reads the information, understands it, and skillfully applies it to matter. Okay. Again, there is no such thing. So it is presented as an enigmatic agent with intent, knowledge, skill, and power. Because things are made with information, it doesn't mean that information is making them. Because information has no such ability. But I think this is the result of the physicalist worldview. They have to say that because if they say they don't say it, they have to talk about, let's say, the agencies, which is non-physical, and they don't want to do that. Okay. But keep in mind that information is not an agent. It can only be an attribute of an agent. And information can be used by an active agent with intent, knowledge, and power as a template for change. It can be a template, but information itself has no intent, no knowledge, and no power to initiate or cause a change. A simple example, this pizza recipe, okay, has all the information on how to make pizza, okay? But you can get the best pizza recipe. That pizza recipe has no ability to read the instructions, understand them, act on the instructions, and make pizza out of the ingredients nearby by organizing them. But this is exactly what they are saying, okay? Here are the instructions. Here is the code, okay? Clearly writes, see, there is, you know, one-to-one correspondence. So those instructions make it. And if you change the instructions, you get a different kind of pizza. See, one-to-one, I told you, the instructions are doing that, okay? This is the situation right now. And people with the, you know, brightest known minds are saying these things. Why? Because they are limiting themselves to physical existence. But I think you be the judge of this here. Now, okay, recipe is information, but it has no knowledge of making pizza. And a recipe cannot order the ingredients to move around, okay? And it takes only a conscious being to read and understand the recipe and to have the power and skill to command over the ingredients there. If let's say we see a pizza being made from ingredients exactly as prescribed in the recipe, there is only one explanation, which is there is a chef around, whether we see it or not. Okay, there is a chef. That is an external conscious mind. Okay. An able being who can read, who can understand, and who can move the ingredients around. Same is true, let's say, for a house. If, let's say, you get the blueprints, it has all the information related to construction of this house, okay? But that information cannot move the construction material around as prescribed here and build that house, okay? This is laughable, but this is exactly what we are doing. Or let's say traffic signs. This, okay, we stop at the traffic sign, but claiming that, you know, the traffic signs have the power, okay, to rule over the traffic, to stop the vehicles. Okay, they don't do that. They can't do that. Signs are not agents, okay? Same with DNA. DNA is simply just inscription, writing, nothing else, okay? It has just four letters, okay? They are simply inscriptions made of atoms, just like ink. You wrote it using ink or using, you know, the DNA letters there. The atoms are directly there. Therefore, the DNA, saying that, you know, the DNA builds things or the RNA copied, okay? Saying exactly like the pizza recipe makes the pizza, okay? For example, the DNA. There are instructions, but DNA cannot read the instructions, okay? and then just build a task-oriented bio robots, okay? And then giving them specific tasks, whatever. You are imagining, you know, a powerful agent there, and it is not there. It is not in the letters. It is not in zeros and ones. It is not in this letters of A, C, G, T there. Same, let's say, with trees. Here is an orange seed. It is simply an inscription. It has all the instructions, okay, specifications for orange tree, just like a blueprint, but that blueprint cannot make this orange tree, okay? It is simply a writing, that's it. Just like the blueprints of a house. And not only that, for life, okay? Yeah, let's say this is a natural seed and this is artificial one, okay? You can build the artificial seed and make it exactly the same as the natural seed, atom by atom. And when you bury both of them into the soil, this, the natural seed will germinate and grow as you see here, but nothing will happen to the artificial seed. Why? All the writings are there. All the information symbols are there. There is something non-physical, life, which is not there, okay? And life comes with all those, I think, representative things there. It is the reason that the life is a mystery. And intentionality, okay? Information has no intention, cannot have an intention to initiate things. Like, you know, making an apple, this or that, whatever that. Because the information is not even aware of itself, does not know anything. And finally, a computer virus, okay? It is also information, okay? But the computer virus doesn't do anything. All those zeros and ones, okay? They represent commands, information, whatever, but it is not an active agent. If you take the virus, okay, copy it, put it on your hard disk, nothing will happen, okay? You have to activate it for it, let's say, to do the commands on it. And again, it is not because virus is doing bad things. It is because the writer of that virus, the information writer, okay, is simply put that intent, the purpose in there. So that when it is executed, okay, it does the harm. Otherwise, the virus has no intention of doing any harm. And finally, there is talk about the evil information, monsters, robots, you know, occupying the world, a lot of things. Keep in mind that there are no evil information and no monsters, robots. Why? Because they are not conscious and they can never be conscious. We see no consciousness in things other than living beings and only among those higher animals and human beings. Therefore, you cannot make a conscious being out of non-life. There is no example of it. But there are evil and monstrous people with consciousness, with intent, with a purpose, and with power. I think we should watch out for those. I think the information itself or the non-living things. We should be afraid of the people who will use or abuse those things. Anyway, I'll stop here. I think I exceeded my time a little bit. And if there are any questions or comments, we can continue discussing these things.
Thank you, Yunus Hocam. I will just chime in on behalf of friends. You know, it's kind of, we forgot to introduce you. So it's good that there are more people right now to get to know you for those who doesn't know you. Yunus Cengel is an emeritus professor at University of Nevada. Personally, I have known Yunus Hocam for a long time, and I really got benefited from his scientific works as well as his intellectual works, and as well as his understanding of Risale-i-Nur. I got really benefited from him, and I still get benefit from him a lot, including today's excellent presentation. So Yunus Cengel also wrote many engineering books, which are still being updated and adopted in many international universities, including thermodynamics, heat transfer, fluid mechanics. These are excellent books, and we are all the engineers, I think, touch these books somehow. Besides, Yunus Hocam has really intellectual papers. One of the recent ones published that I'm aware of is on the ontology of life and mind. I do suggest all of you to just Google on the ontology of life and mind to see his last published paper. And these are really, I think, paving the ways to new future for us, especially readers of Risale-i Nur, to see how we can transform or translate the information that we understand in a way that people can understand that how blinded they are, in my point of view. I'm sorry, I just chimed in like this, feeling the need to introduce you. And if there are questions, I think we can take the questions. I see there is a comment in the chat. Am I understanding correctly that a physicalist claims that information itself is a dual agent?
Yes. Uh-huh. I mean, yeah, it is exactly the problem. Since they limit existence to physical existence, okay, matter and energy, it is really in recent years that they finally pay attention to information, because they know that information is not really something physical, okay? But what they did is they took the meaning out and they took the symbols of information and somehow attached the meaning in their mind to it and called it the information as the most important ingredient in existence, because they realize that everything in nature, okay, they are done with knowledge. If let's like look at the moon's surface, let's say we have laws of physics and forces of physics. You may have, let's say, rain, hail, I don't know, earthquakes, whatever, okay, erosions, so irregular things, differently shaped stones, but nothing else. This is all the laws and forces of nature can do. Go to Sahara with no plants, okay, and you will not see anything purposive or significant or for something useful there, except life. But the laws of physics and the laws of physics, okay, if let's say you model the entire universe using all the laws of physics, the ones we know or we don't know, okay, no model can predict the emergence of life. So life is an anomaly. So they have no idea what life is, okay? And with life comes another set of rules and laws and another set of attributes. So life itself is really a different universe. And then with life comes knowledge. All the living beings, okay, they use a lot of knowledge. It is from photosynthesis to, let's say, our kidney doing its job. We have dialysis machines to, I think, do what they are doing. It's such a easy way there. That is, everything is built with knowledge and everything is done with purpose. Everything is goal-oriented, intentional, purposive. And everything is done, I think, with full power. It is something which really rules over the physical realm there. Since the knowledge is template, so things kind of occur while passing those template, okay? So knowledge is undeniable. Therefore, the materialists are physicalists. Now they accept as a main ingredient of existence knowledge, but they present it as a knowledgeable, powerful, purposive agent, okay?
Yunus Hocam, quick question. I heard some people saying, even a professor, some well-educated people saying that we did not prove the particles unconscious yet, being unconscious yet. Did you see any theories like that out there? You know, Ustad defines it like if they don't accept one creator, one single creator, they need to accept gods to the number of particles. It sounds like that to me. Did you see any theories or claims like that out there? Given
kind of... Danny, we can take your question after this. Danny had raised the hand before Baykar Abi, but we can take Danny later if you don't mind.
Okay, let me just answer this, a short answer. Here, there are theories of, you know, universal consciousness. That is, I think when you look at the occurrences in the universe, especially with life, okay, things are done like everything knows what it is doing. Let's say, look at an apple tree, okay? And the material being used there, in the soil, the minerals, the water, the processes, whatever. That is, it looks like everything knows what they are doing, why they are doing, what the result will be, whatever. So there is a kind of a general consciousness there, the universal thing, and a kind of universal knowledge and a universal unity, okay? Because I say in the human body, like 37 trillion cells, each cell is, a unity, like a huge, huge chemical factory. And then all the cells are working together, okay, under one command. There is, unity in the body there. And when you look at all those things, they say, well, there must be a universal thing. Some will call it, let's say, God directly. Some will say universal consciousness, whatever. But it is, I think, really visible to all, okay? Of course, if, let's say, you belong to one of the traditions of, Judaism, Christianity, Islam, monotheistic religions, they will simply say that there is one maker with knowledge, with intent, with a purpose, okay? And obviously with consciousness. So it reflects all of in his doings, just like, our doings reflect us, including all the creations, like the human beings there.
Danny, we can take your question now, if you're available.
Okay, thank you for the opportunity. Okay, thank you a lot, Professor Yunus, for tonight's course, because tonight's course for me actually is the key to unlock the difference between the brain and the soul. So if I wrap up from all the course tonight, I can summarize here, because there are three things here. First is the information as the non-creative agent. The second is about how the brain processes that information, which is a physical activity, the nerve and electricity in our brain. And the third is actually, as you stated before, is the soul that comment. So I would like to make an analogy with the things closest to me in daily life. Can we make an analogy of a piano playing? So for example, there's like a Chopin melody. The information actually itself is the score of the melody. And how the brain proceeds, the nerve and electricity in our brain is actually the physical activity, the movement of the keys in the piano. But actually, the soul that comments is actually the pianist itself. It's a creative agent, a partial creative agent. So can we make that analogy, professors?
Yes, certainly. Certainly we can. We can make, many analogies. And many people have done, similar analogies. And the analogies help us understand these things. So the more the merrier, because remember Harun's question, how come, let's say, when we say a pot or a needle, one hole on one side and the other side is pointed, a piece of, iron, okay? And it is we recognize it as a needle. We say this requires a purposive, knowledgeable, intentional act, that simple needle. So, but let's say when we see an apple tree, somehow, we don't think about it. I think analogies of this kind, whether related to, you know, the piano, the way it works, etc., or the ones that I mentioned, they, I think, make the difference there. That is, help us see and break that curtain of blindness. Okay. So I think, you know, anything goes.
I think it's really explaining. Thank you, Professor.
Yeah, thank you.
Yunus Hocam, how can we think about dreams? I mean, when you talk about information processing, in our dreams, is it related to our minds or kind of some specific faculties of human instead of mind in general going over there? Because I believe we are not conscious in our dreams, but to some extent we come to conscious what we just woke up. And even, you know, there's a nice movie on this, Inception, very famous. They're making use of this. Whenever you are conscious in your dream, you just wake up. But also dreaming is something related to being human, I believe. So how this is different than the physical universe in terms of information?
Yeah, good question. I think if people, you know, just think about the dream, okay, the reality of dream, I think they'll understand a lot of things. Because see, right now, the neuroscience cannot explain dreams. That is, they say it is just anomaly and lots of, you know, short circuiting, whatever, so kind of, you know, meaningless neural activity, okay? Because all this is in the brain, the neural activity, the electrical signals there, which are, I think, disconnected and non-purposive, because when the chemicals move around, they are charged particles. Then in a neuron, the voltage exceeds a certain level as a result of, let's say, ions, let's say, gathering there. Then it generates an electric, you know, pulse, and another pulse, whatever. Look at, let's say, the fireworks on 4th of July, okay? That has a lot of, you know, fireworks. Nothing can happen from those fireworks. When, let's say, it reaches a certain temperature, they are, you know, fired or whatever. Unless you arrange it, plan it from the very beginning to form certain shapes, the fireworks, okay, will not do anything there. If there is, let's say, a meaningful thing, then there is, you know, some, I think, active agent behind it. For example, on the rosters we see LCD screens, okay? For example, what it says, for example, Joe's Coffee House, hot coffee. And we know that there are thousands, if not hundreds of thousands of pixels there, okay? And now imagine those pixels just, you know, firing randomly and then saying, you know, Joe's Coffee House, okay? Kind of shaping that way. It cannot happen. The only way it will happen is behind it, we need someone who will rule over those, you know, pixels. Kind of, you know, will arrange which one will light up, and then when they light up, you know, what they will mean, whatever. That is in the brain. If let's say you simply say that everything is all those electric signals do nothing. In the batteries of our cell phones, in the microprocessors of our computers, okay? A lot of signal activity. Billions of transistors in some larger microprocessors, okay? A lot of signals. Those signals cannot do anything. They are governed. They are ruled by something which is outside the microprocessor. If a microprocessor is doing something meaningful, okay? Instead of just, you know, simply a maze of meaningless symbols, signals, then there is something behind it, kind of ruling through those signals, kind of, you know, doing other things. No matter how you look at it, it looks like there is something non-physical, an agency which rules over matter, commands the matter through the brain, okay? And there is one-to-one correspondence between, let's say, those brain activity and the X that follow. For example, dreams. Normally, when we dream, okay, we are in in a certain sleep mode. Our brain is fully functional. The brain activity doesn't slow down. Yet, we are really dead. We don't hear anything. We don't see anything. We are simply dead. Yet, we live a normal life. That is, we go through some adventures there. We even eat. Right. As I eat an apple, oh, it is very pleasurable. Which means the pleasure of eating an apple, okay, has nothing to do really with the taste buds. Even if you don't have that, actual apple and the electrical signals, it looks like the thing that works through the brain, the soul, the mind, the spirit, whatever you call it. Obviously, it is doing, all the generation of the sensations and experiencing, either through the physical body or without it. And when a person is asleep, it is like, semi-dead, okay? Consciousness is not there, but since we remember the dreams, it is partially there because we are aware of the dreams there, okay? If let's say someone, pricks a needle into your leg, you may feel like, a dog is biting you. That is the, somehow it will be replayed in a different way there. But in the dream, we have the scenario and everything. So it shows that, I think, very clearly, when the body is dead, there is something vividly living, okay, beyond the body. And the weaker the body, the stronger the other thing, that agency there. And it cannot be the making of the neuron firings, electric signals, because let's say on TV, we see a show, TV show, okay? The beginning, the adventure, the end, whatever. And then you tell about, let's say, that show there. Now, can you imagine on the TV, we may have thousands of pixels. Now, can you imagine the pixels just coming on randomly, okay? They're all connected. Pixels just light up randomly. And then we have a TV show, very cohesive, meaningful show. And I am claiming, there must be some outside the makers of this, because it requires, some knowledge, intent, control of these things or whatever. And the random turning on and off of the pixels cannot create a TV show. That there is a team of people, minds behind it. If someone says, no, I don't see it, I don't believe it, it is the pixels. And the person will say, look, I'll prove it to you. I break that part of the TV. Now see, there is no show there. That means if the TV screen is, intact, I see the full show. If let's say you break part of the TV, there is no show there. That means the TV is making this show. It is exactly, what they are doing with the brain. Okay, it is, I think, that out of mind, so to speak. Therefore, I think the dream world is obviously non-physical, okay, but very real. That is the taste, the sights we see, the sounds we hear, everything, the five senses, the emotions from happiness to fear, all those things. It shows that there is something non-physical, okay, which does all the experiencing and sensing. In the real world, it does it through the physical body mostly. In the dream, the physical body is out of order, and then it does it without the physical body. Therefore, when a person dies, I think to me it is very clear that something will continue doing that, because it is just one entity, an active agent with all the capabilities, and other than the physical body, including our nerves, heart, mind, memory, intellect, everything, I think they will be going somewhere else and continue existence in a non-physical way. So to me, it is, I think, clear proof for the existence of life after that. Just a dream.
Yeah, there's a comment, mashallah, nice explanation. There was one more question, if still who wants to ask the question. I can't see, but Yunus Hocam, we can hold you much more here. You know, I have a lot of questions, but I don't want to take your time. We hope to see you later. And let me I just found myself in just moderating this session, although I didn't intend to, but it's a pleasure for me. So any more questions to ask Yunus Hocam?
Let me also say that I sent the PDF of this presentation to you, Harun, then you can share it with everybody.
Okay, thank you. Yes, if anybody is interested, we can just send you the presentation.
And we will put it on our website as well, inshallah. LH4H.org, like lighthouseforhumanity.org, inshallah.
And thank you all for the attendance and interest.
Yunus Hocam, by the way, before closing, do you have any suggestions in terms of, you know, let's say young generation to work on some topics, let's say philosophical, or let's say in connection with reading Risale-i-Nur? What would be your suggestions to approach to bring about this kind of, for us, somewhat obvious, but in terms of humanity, with this stubbornness? And also we have problem with communication with people because of our, let's say, closed way of communication. What do you suggest for young generations?
Oh, I think the young and the old and the middle-aged for everyone.
Especially, let me say.
I think for you and me, there are really a lot of things to be done, okay? So I think Risale-i-Nur is a very good resource. That is, it is an eye-opener. It is a straight. But just saying the right thing is not enough. That is, to say it in the right way, in a way that the audience will be receptive. That is, to be able to look at things from others' perspective. And if, let's say, they are really good in certain things, to clarify the things. For example, today I try to clarify what knowledge and information is, the true nature of it. If, let's say, you have expertise in any area, for example, I mentioned a few things about the brain, but if a neuroscientist, for example, okay, can certainly see this at a much deeper level than I possibly can. They can, let's say, do that. A computer scientist, let's say, can do the same thing. That is, if we clarify things and put things into their rightful places, okay, and simply present the things in a simple way, easy to understand, and just, you know, just stop there. The minds, the I think inquiring minds will find it and will consume it. That is, bring it to that form. Any good material in this age of, you know, information and communication, any good material finds its customers. Therefore, let's just do good things and put it out there. That's it. nothing else.
Thank you so much, Yunus Hocam. It was a very nice closing also. Also, there's a comment. I appreciate you, Yunus Hocam. I'd like to become a copy of this nice, very informative presentation. I think Abdullah is from Üsküdar University. He just, I don't know the full name. I see Abdullah, but just asking for the copy of this presentation in Üsküdar University.
Okay, you can send it to everyone, Harun.
Yeah, but I believe he's asking you to present this in Üsküdar University. I don't know, maybe he will contact you.
Oh yeah, we can always do that, yeah.
All right, all right. Thank you, hocam. Have a great night. Wonderful.
Thank you, you too. And I hope I see you all again. And you all good. Take care of yourselves.